oh yeah, he's the guy with the big gun and all that stuff. But that wasn't what I was seeing about it in terms of work. I was looking at it going, wow, look at the other guy in the movie. Like, I'm not talking about, like, I don't want to be Clint Eastwood. He's got that covered, right? But look at the other guy in his movie. Same sort of thing where the other guy, the second banana, gets amazing focus. Clint gives him complete focus. He's an absolute equal on the screen. He gives him all kinds of equal focus. And not all the actors were acting equals or even presence. Didn't have the presence of Clint. He still gives to all the actors. He gives them their moment. He gives them a shot. Whether they do it or not is up to them. But I thought, man, I could kill one of these movies. I could be great in one of these. There's lots of, you know, kind of fun action stuff to do. There's some funny repartee. You get some jokes. The sidekick gets all the funny stuff. And Clint gets to go, you know. And then you get killed. And you so that Clint can avenge you. And you have a fantastic death scene. It's like, this is brilliant. I want this gig. So I called him up and I said, hey, you know, I really like the way this goes. I'd like to be in one of your things. He said, well, would you be interested in doing another service comedy? Because I'd just done Stripes or something. I said I didn't want to
become a service comedy guy.
Become a service comedy guy. It probably wouldn't have happened, but I just didn't feel like doing two of them in a row. I felt like I had to stay a little loose. But he had a great one. I wish I'd done it too. It was about the end of World War II when they had millions of pieces of machinery and ships and so forth. And he had this sort of supply sergeant character that was shaking and moving, just dealing all this equipment, you know. I wish I'd done it. It would have been fun.
One of the service comedies I know that you like, if somebody we don't often think of as being a comedian, is William Holden in Stalag 17.
When Stalag 17 comes on, I can't turn it off. I have to watch it. I have to go all the way with that movie because it's a Swiss watch. It's just a gorgeous movie. It's just great. And Bill Holden is like the great anti-hero hero in that thing. He is such a son of a bitch. He is so, and yet you know this guy's got something. He's got a secret. He's got a, you know, he's got a bird in his mouth. He's got something, and you got to know what it is. You got to know what he's going to do. And even though I've seen it many times, I'm still fascinated at watching him turn the worm.
So you're stuck with me, huh? Maybe the Russian broads would take him.
Not with that kisser. Not anymore.
You got off lucky last night, Sefton. One more move and you'll wake up with your throat cut.
You listening, Sefton?
Yeah, I still got one good ear. Now you listen to me. There are two guys in this barracks that know I didn't do it. Me and the guy that did do it. And it could be any one of you. You, Hoffy, or Duke, or Price, or the Animal, or Blondie, or even Joey. And he'd better watch out, the guy that left me holding the stick. Because if there are gonna be any throats cut in this barracks...
And I just thought Bill Holden was great. I loved him in Network. I thought it was like a total stud. Like a totally stud performance in Network. I thought it was amazing. And, you know, you see these older movies with the guy. The guy worked with his shirt off for the whole movie in Picnic. I think it's Picnic. He's, you know, we care about guys that take their shirts off. Here's this guy was, you know, the muscles. The muscles from Brussels, he was. But he was, but also a very physical guy. Obviously, he was in unbelievable shape. And, you know, to do a movie on a closed set like that, in a concentration camp or whatever that was, prisoner of war camp.
Yeah.
To be in a box like that for a long time, you got to really, your body, you can't let your body go dormant. You can't let your body go to sleep in there. And he must have really been working in between, like keeping his body alert to stay sharp.
But that kind of, the thing that he did, I mean, then that, what, again, we're talking about using a kind of physicality in a really small space. I mean, he takes up a lot of weight. He takes up a lot of space now, given he doesn't move around a lot and he's sitting there a lot. And I figured that that kind of sort of stillness, that powerful stillness, is something that I see in a lot of the stuff you do too. I mean, there's a lot of that, what you would call a William Holden performance in Lost in Translation. And I figure that's somewhere in you that's got to resonate a little bit too, what Holden does.
Yeah, you're right. He's in that, he's sitting in that bed and he's not doing much of anything. You know, he might just turn his head a little bit, but he is, his body is completely buzzing. He's alive. He's got a secret and his whole body is like, God, I'm going to get these bastards have been grinding me down. I'm going to get them, you know. I hate the guys on my side as much as I hate the guys on the other side. That must have been an amazing feeling. You know, that was, it's a very cool performance. Nice.
We're talking about actors, though. We can't not talk about Tootsie and how you took what was a barely a part and improvised it into a pretty crucial portion of the movie.
Well, the credit really goes to Elaine May. She's like the smartest, funniest. There's a girl. Talk about going crazy for funny girls.
Right.
Elaine May is like the most attractive woman in the world. She is so funny and so smart. I mean, if I'd come up when Elaine May was coming up, I would have chained her to a typewriter and made love to her like every 4 hours just to keep her, you know, just to keep her going, because she is the funniest. She's really funny. She just kills me. And she's also someone who I've seen eat like an entire pound of cherries, you know, just like I was eating the lemons that time. I've seen her eat a whole, she's crazy about cherries. But anyway, so I really am having a breakdown, I suppose. But Elaine had the idea for this roommate character that there, somehow you needed to represent audience point of view in the film. And it didn't exist before this character that I played arrived. And my character arrived like a week before shooting or something like that, you know. I was sort of, you know, I'd just done the Ghostbusters, and I was sort of a Columbia favorite. I'd done Stripes, a couple movies in a row there that they were happy with. And, you know, I hear that Dustin wants you to be in the movie. He wants you in the movie to be. And he and Sidney were arguing about, you know, what time the sun came up. They argue about anything. So the idea that Sidney wanted one guy to play the part and Dustin all of a sudden wanted me, just because it was like another thing. So I ended up with the job. But the day I joined the movie, it was already officially a box office disaster. There'd already been a story in the New York Times saying that they were weeks behind schedule. They're fighting over everything. A terrible disaster. And I got on the set, and here's the set, here's the cameras and everything, and there's like 65 crew members that are 80 feet away, you know, yards and yards away. I'm like, what's going on here? No one wanted to be anywhere near these blow-ups that were happening all the time. So I started insulting Sidney, because Sidney's like, you know, he's a neurotic Jewish director with cowboy boots, you know. And I was like, hey, Tex, yo, get over here, you know, that kind of thing, you know. And I would give him all this grief, and the crew's going like, what the hell's going on? So they kind of creep in to see what was going on. And then I started making fun of Dustin, the same, you know, whatever it was for that. So it just dragged everyone back in. And they kind of liked it, you know, everyone kind of liked it. The scenes worked. They kept making more scenes. They say, okay, let's make another one. How about we make another one? And every time we did it, I remember when I auditioned, I actually did have to audition. I had to audition with Dustin. And we did this scene. We did it about 4 or 5 times. First time we did it, I sort of was like, you know, giving him more. We did it again, I gave him even more. We did it again, I gave him even more. We did it a third time, and the scene was completely and totally about him. And it was all about him. Everything I did set him up, it was all about him. And he looked at me and went, let's do it one more time. And we did it, and it was absolutely even. It was perfectly even. He wanted to see if he could trust me to do it. And it was like, okay, we're cool. So from that time on, I could do anything in any of the scenes. And he didn't care. There was never going to be any intent to upstage. There was never going to be any intent to say, to like, steal. You couldn't upstage a guy who's in a bra and panties.
She has seen me in all of these.
Wait, she hasn't seen you in the white thing.
What, this?
Yeah.
You cannot wear white to a casual dinner. It's too dressy.
You couldn't wear pants?
No, no, pants, I can't.
What about this thing?
No, no, I don't have the right shoes for it. I hate the way the horizontal lines make me look too hippie, and it cuts me across the bust.
I think we're getting into a weird area here.
This is smart. What about this? Seriously.
Well, you look like you should be ringing a school bell.
You know, this may seem silly to you, but this is our first date. I just want to look pretty for her.
What do you show your kids? I mean, what kind of movies do you watch with your family?
I thought you said, what do you feed your kids?
No, what do you show your kids? I know that's quite an age range, too.
Well, I try to, you know, I'm crazy about Hoosiers is a movie I can watch at any time. That's another movie I cannot turn off, because I love Hoosiers.
That's not too sentimental for you?
It's not. It's not, because to me, And I can cry at Hoosiers too. I will. I used to cry at Burger King commercials. I can go. I've had a lot of pain since. I don't cry quite so easily. I'm tough. But Hoosiers makes me cry and laugh at the same time. Hoosiers, because it's corn, But corn's okay. You know, it's not like an Irish wake where it's, oh, he's gone to a better place. He's up there with someone. You know, that kind of corn. It's, there's a different sort of thing where there's a history of corn. Indiana basketball is a corn tradition. And you want to root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. You want to see the little guy make the, you know, come out of nowhere. It's real, and it's only how it's executed, you know, that makes it sappy or sentimental. It's emotion. You have to have emotion, but it's when you execute it poorly, or you arrive at sentimentality, then you have to take those people out and shoot them. You got to take them out in the cornfield and bury them, like Joe Pesci. Okay. Casino. But it brings me to what I think about movies. In general, I mean, my big movie experience occurred when I lived in Paris for a while, and they have these cycles of films they do. You know, they can do all kinds of different things. And they were starting at the very beginning, and they were starting with silent movies. I remember the first day I went in there, I was so excited. I sat down, and this movie came up. It was called A Romance of Happy Valley, I think is the title, by D.W. Griffith. It was a film that was thought gone, and they found a print of it in Russia, like in 1974, six. And this movie's just incredible. It's just, this guy's really good. It's perfect storytelling. The subtitles are in Russian. I have no idea what the people are saying, no idea. There's just Russian words and pictures. And just with the pictures, it was all completely clear. And it was like a thunderbolt hit me. I was like, whoa, what would a guy like me do in that business at that time? You know, I wouldn't be working in the movies, you know? Without a tongue, who am I, you know? So, and that was the first day, and I walked home like in shock, like, whoa. There were people doing this that long ago that made a great movie without any words, without any sound. And it was perfect. So I continued going and saw all the whole history of it. I saw the first camera move, you know, the first time the camera moved. You know, I saw all these things the first time this happened, the first time all these different effects happened. And I was just awestruck. And as the months went by, I just kept saying, how could you see all these movies and make some of the movies that are made today? How could you make it? And so, like, when I think about getting out of bed to go to work, you know, or taking a job or something, I think, like, wow, how could this be worth doing a movie when someone really knew how to do it 100 years ago, really knew how to do it effectively then, you know? You know, the people that are doing this game, do they know what they're doing, or are they just people that want to be glamorous or something, you know? I mean, it's hard to make a movie. It's hard to make a bad movie. It's hard to make a bad movie. It's hard work. But if you've seen the great movies, you've got to feel that obligation to, you know, get it right. Jeez.
Well, that's probably a good point to end it. We got to go. So thanks for doing this.
Should I go take a leak? All those who think I should hit the rest and raise
your
hand.
Oh, that's enough of this. That's enough of this. Thank you, Bill.
You're welcome.
Joke about an angel. But someday you'll find out who your friend is.
What a grip. That's from counting money. What an imagination. That's from writing movies.